Greetings, my future AP minions. Hey, my name is Mr. Weaver. I am your friendly neighborhood English teacher for advanced placement English literature and composition here at Northeastern High School. Hey, I got a couple of emails regarding our pre-coursework assignment for AP Lit and Comp. True to my word, I had mentioned to those individuals who had emailed me that I would get that out to you today here. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Again, I said I would release it by May 26th, and we're going to make good on that. So I needed yesterday and the day before to kind of finalize some things. So look, let me start off by saying this. If you talk to past advanced placement English literature and composition students, they will tell you that they had to do more work than I'm asking you guys to do this summer. And I want to start off by letting you guys know that is largely due to the fact that we have some uncertainty with the fall. We don't know exactly what that's going to look like with this whole coronavirus thing. But I do still need to prepare you for some aspects of the class via some pre-coursework, but it's not going to be quite as substantial because, again, it's a little up in the air what the fall is going to look like, and that might necessitate some adjustments and changes to the class and would result in some adjustments to the coursework. So I'm kind of erring on the side of caution with this. To that end, I want to kind of run you through the requirements for AP Lit and Comp pre-coursework for the summer and kind of show you around where a few things are. So let's go ahead and get started. Hey, on the screen, you can see the Google Doc. I also have the link to the Google Doc in the email that I'm sending out to you guys to this document as well as a few others. So go ahead and you can take a look certainly at this with me. So look, for this summer, you are going to be responsible for reading two books from kind of the list that's below. We'll get to that in just a second. In past years, I've had students read four, but I think I'm going to scale it back to two and scale back the requirements a little based on what I had just mentioned. So let's talk about these two books and what you're going to do with them. So the first book is mandatory. It is required reading. It is Snow Falling on Cedars by David Gooderson. Now, I don't know what you know about this book or what you don't. It's kind of a murder mystery book as far as that goes. It does have some historical implications. It does deal with Japanese Americans. It takes place on a fictional island somewhere off the coast of like Washington, Oregon. It's known as San Pedro Island. There's a murder that takes place off the coast of that island. And there's a Japanese American who's accused of this murder. There's a reporter involved who has kind of there's a love triangle that exists in this book. It's a very interesting book. It's actually David Gooderson, the author, was an AP English teacher, I think, for a number of years. Might have been Bainbridge High School, it seems to me, then went ahead and decided he was going to write some magazine articles, wrote a little bit of poetry, and decided he was going to write a novel. So he wrote this one, and it did receive an award or two. I forget what the award was that it received, but it's gotten some critical acclaim as a pretty good book. So I'm going to have you read this one, and then the second book I'm going to have you read is going to be your choice, and I'm going to give you five different choices here. Hey, by the way, just popping back up here for a second, if you're not sure which one of these five you want to read, look, don't just grab the shortest one, because, you know, I'm going to tell you, The Stranger is easily the shortest book in this list, but it's a very existential novel. Look, it's a book that students tell me that they either love or totally hate. I really get nobody in the middle. I have no students that ever say to me, you know, The Stranger was okay. They usually are like, I love this book. It's like my new Bible. Or they are like, I don't get it. This makes no sense whatsoever. It's a very different kind of read. So, back to the point I wanted to make here. If you're not sure what choice you want to make here, I have put a link to a short Google Slides presentation here that kind of outlines the six books that are listed. Obviously, these five, and gives you a little more information on Snow Falling on Cedars as well, so that you can make an informed choice. So I would encourage you to look at that Google Slides presentation and, make that informed choice with regards to the optional read. So, again, you're going to be reading two books for me. Let's talk about what you're going to do with those two books, starting with the required reading, Snow Falling on Cedars. So, look, I am very much a believer that all of us is smarter than any one of us. And, you know, you're going to notice when we take, when we get into the AP Lit and Comp course next year, whether that's in the classroom, online, hybridized, on the moon, wherever, folks, you're going to notice we will engage in a number of very critical, analytical kinds of discussions regarding the works that we're analyzing, from poetry to short fiction to prose to plays and so on. I do that because, you know, when we share those ideas, we can build off one another's ideas. It opens us up to different interpretations. It opens us up to different schools of literary criticism we can apply, and ultimately results in a smarter, more intellectually stimulating environment, which is great for you guys when you're preparing not only for the AP Lit and Comp test, but for college and, let's be honest, life in general. So we're going to get a head start on this kind of, you know, critical, analytical discussion via an online discussion this summer using Snow Falling on Cedars as kind of the focal point. So you are going to need to join our Any Bobcat Schoology AP pre-coursework page. That is this right here. And you're going to join that with the code that is listed right here. You're going to get that again. You're going to get this document in the email. So it should be pretty easy to sign up for our class to get in there. Then you're going to read Snow Falling on Cedars. And I want you to, as you're reading, and I've given you a reading schedule below. Check it out. This is the reading schedule. We'll get to that in just a second. But what I want you to do with it is the following. As you're reading each set of chapters, you'll start off in the first week with chapters 1 through 6, for instance. I'd like you to be thinking about taking notes. You know, you could buy your copy of the book if you'd like. You're welcome to get it from a library. I will tell you, I just looked it up on Amazon. I'll flip over here. If you're a fan of audiobooks, and, you know, I have no problems with audiobooks, it appears you can get it free if you get a free trial of Audible, or if you have an Audible membership. That's a possibility there. You can get it on Kindle, whatever the case may be. Look, I don't care if you take notes in the margins of the book. I don't care if you take 2-column notes. You know, if you have an eidetic memory, I guess you don't need to do any of that. But that said, I would like you to be noticing the things like setting, the characters, the tone, the theme or themes that are starting to develop in this work. The figurative language, there's a lot of figurative language, diction, the syntax is particularly interesting in this book. And any connections that you make between this book and the outside world, you know, those like text-to-world or text-to-text or even text-to-self connections, I think are important. I mean, you guys have talked about those probably since like middle school. That said, you will not earn credit from your post by just summarizing the text that you've read. Instead, I want you to comment on one or more of these areas. And don't just say, hey, I saw a simile here in chapter 4. Talk about what the simile does, what it means, why it's important, how it ties into the larger work, or how it ties into things maybe outside of that work. These are all really interesting ideas. And, you know, am I asking you to comment on all of these things each week? No. But, like, comment on one or two of them. Or you could comment on, like, the characters, maybe, and how they're tying into what you see as an emerging theme or motif. That would be fascinating. Basically, what I'm looking for here is I'm looking for an intelligent post. I'm looking for a post that shows that you have some ability to analyze literature. Now, look, we haven't really talked about that in a formalized setting. You haven't even taken the class yet. But that's kind of what I'm looking for with that. So, oh, by the way, once you have posted your, you know, analytical paragraph, let's say, I'm not really looking for an essay here, a paragraph would suffice. I would like you to respond substantively to at least one other classmate's posting. Now, what do I mean by the word substantively? Because that's kind of a vague term. Look, here's what I'm not looking for. I'm not looking for, good job, that was an awesome post. Hey, you're the man, or you're the person. I'm looking for something substantive, like, hey, you know what? That figurative language element, that simile that you identified, that metaphor you identified, that diction that you really brought up for conversation, I saw that too, and here's how I connected it. I connected it to this, even though you may have connected it to that. Or, hey, I also actually connected it to this, and here's why I did that, maybe for a slightly different reason. I'm looking for substantive feedback. The idea being that you are generating an ongoing discussion throughout the summer. And, you know, the whole thing, as I mentioned here, is worth 40 points. I'm not looking for a conversation, you know, or I'm not looking for you to burn your entire summer on this. I mean, if you take a look, this whole thing, I'm looking for you to post your first discussion, chapters 1 through 6, by June 12th. Then you've got another week just to respond to somebody else. And, you know, I don't care who you respond to, but respond to one of them. Hey, then I'm looking by the end of June for you to have chapters 7 through 14 read and post. Then I'm giving you another week to respond. And we're just going to work down through. So at the end, you're going to have 5 posts and you're going to have 5 responses to someone else. Oh, and I want to point out here too. Look, I put this kind of at the very end. I don't care if you work ahead on this assignment. Folks, I have every single one of these opened up for you over here in Schoology. I don't care if you burn through the entire novel, put all of your posts down, and then go back and, you know, weekly put your responses in. Look, I don't care if you get together with another classmate, you're like, hey, look, let's burn through this novel in a week. I'll respond to your posts, you respond to mine, and we'll be done a week from now with this. Great, that's awesome. Here's the only thing I'm asking for you to do, folks. I have no problem with you working ahead. I do not want you to fall behind because it creates some chaos with regards to that. So please don't do that. Hey, so let's talk about the second book. Here's the second thing I'm looking for, folks. I am looking for you to write me a theme analysis book on whatever other optional read you've chosen. When I say theme analysis, look, keep in mind, a theme must be arguable, first of all. And, you know, you should engage in a discussion of things like detail, imagery, diction, syntax, figurative language, you know, at least three of those, I would think, maybe more if you can. And I think you should be engaging in the discussion, not just about these things, but how they help to establish the theme. You see, these literary elements aren't, you know, ends to themselves. They're they're a means to an end, which is usually the establishment of a theme. But I'd like you to take it further if you can. How does that theme relate to the work as a whole, and by extension, to society at large? Another way of saying this is, why is that theme important that you identified? Why does it matter? Look, I've chosen these works very deliberately because I think they have themes that are very relevant, and in many cases, somewhat timeless. That could be overlaid on current society, that could be overlaid on current politics, on current social issues, and so on. So I'd like you to explore that in a theme analysis essay. Hey, that'll be worth 24 points. You'll notice it's due by August the 9th. Again, I don't care if you do it next week and get it in early. I'll go ahead and grade it if you do. That said, folks, I am looking for it to be done by the 9th at the latest, so it gives me at least a week or two before the school year starts to grade those, to get those in the gradebook for you. So, hey, as far as grading them, I should mention, I will use a standard AP 6-point rubric, which is right here. You're welcome to email me if you have any other questions about this. But that's pretty much the summer assignment. It's two books. One is discussion then on Snow Falling on Cedars. The optional read is a 5-paragraph essay, maybe 6 paragraphs tops. But look, I'm not looking for a doctoral thesis with regards to this theme analysis. Not at all. All right. Hey, only other thing I wanted to mention to you guys is this. If we jump back over to our AP pre-coursework page, I did want to point out a few other things that I listed here for you for your benefit. You'll notice the AP pre-coursework materials. This is what we just went over. Here is the optional reading list. And I also put a list of the most frequently cited AP Lit and Comp works on the test as of last year. So kind of interesting data if you want to take a look at that. A couple other things that I put down for you. Obviously, these are the discussion posts for Snow Falling on Cedars. Here's where you'll turn in your theme analysis essay. Here's an audiobook. It is the AP Guide to Getting a 5. You're welcome to listen to that. Download it on your phone, listen to it in your car or, you know, by the pool or whatever. It might give you some pointers, some tips. And, you know, if you like AP audiobooks in general, this is a folder with some additional AP audiobooks that you could listen to that are, you know, of AP merit. I mean, you know, we've got a couple short stories in here, but things like Frankenstein, Dracula, Heart of Darkness, these are all viable works for the AP Lit and Comp test. So you could check those out if you'd like. And hey, finally, last couple things here. Here's a few review apps. I stuck with the Google Play Store because I'm a kind of a fan of Google Play. I'm not really an iPhone person. So a couple apps in there that you could download if you want, you know, like a one will send you like a practice AP Lit and Comp question a day that you could check out. And the final thing I put here at the bottom, if you are really looking for things to do this summer, these are the links to all of the AP Literature and Composition reviews that were put in place for this year's AP Lit and Comp Kids. So you could listen to all like 26 of those if you really want to. I'm not telling you to do that, but if you really want to, you could. We may make some use of those next year. So that pretty much is it then. That kind of brings to a close our AP 2021 pre-coursework. Thank you guys for listening. I appreciate it. Hey, feel free to reach out any Bobcat or Weaver B at anybobcats.org if you have any questions. Make sure you have a little fun, get some sun this summer. Don't bury your entire summer into this, but certainly do pay some attention to it. And hey, folks, as always, and you're going to hear me say this probably 8,000 times throughout your class, whether you have me in the fall or the spring, make sure that you seize each and every day. Carpe diem.